sure this talk is accessible to a wide audience, and so that everyone tonight can walk away with solid understanding of the web, how the web works, and how it functions. So I'm going to be going over some very basic terms and knowledge of the internet. So let's get started. So in the 1990s, Tim Berners-Lee, a scientist at CERN, the European Organization of Nuclear Research, developed something called the Hypertext Markup Language, HTML. Have you guys heard of it?
No.
Great. So how does this work? So a valid HTML document contains HTML tags like this, and another closing tag like that. And everything between these tags are the content that's going to be shown on the browser most of the time. The browser sees each of these tags and understands that there's a specific set of rules that we apply to each one of them. For example, an italic tag, an I tag, means render me in the italic form. And a B tag, we rendered in bold. Those angle brackets, wherever they are in the document, means an instruction is coming. Okay, so that's great. But what happens, let's say, if I want to display the actual less than sign? Does the browser get confused? Well, you can use something called a character escape. You'll be hearing this term escape a lot throughout this presentation. Instead of using the angle bracket, you write an ampersand, and then LT for less than, and then a semicolon. This instructs the browser to display a regular angle bracket, and not treat it as colon. Awesome, so now you know the art of escaping in HTML. So as new versions of HTML get released throughout the years, and the language has become more powerful. For example, we are able to specify different type of input types, such as checkbox, dropdowns, or radio buttons. We are even able to do form validation by using pure HTML. Let's look at a live example. Awesome site where users can reserve Jonas Brothers concert tickets.
Yes.
In order to avoid scalpers, each user can only reserve a maximum amount of 3 tickets. So let's see what happens. We'll click the increase button, and it will stop at 3. Okay, so that's working as expected. But here I am, a poor developer who is desperately in need of money. And I'm gonna try to hack this and resell these popular Jonas Brothers concert tickets at double the price. So what I'm gonna do is inspect this input element.
Yep.
And see what is controlling it that it has a limitation of 3. Awesome, so I am getting 10 tickets, but I'm also very poor, so I definitely want this gold member discount. Right now, I can't click on it because it's disabled. And of course, I'm going to have that. So let's try to select this checkbox. And I see that nothing in the HTML is disabling it, but it's in the class. There's a disable button. And these are your stylings for your input fields. I see that there is a disable attribute. I'm gonna turn that off. Now I can click on the discount. Yay, I just purchased 10 tickets with discount and I'm gonna resell them at double the price. So what I just showed is client state manipulation. But keep in mind, this attack is only completed if the client of this website is making an API request to the backend with the manipulated value I just tweeted. There are cases where client sites like these are more secure and they do kind of validate the values, and the value they get sent to backend would not be influenced by these type of DOM manipulation. However, that's not going to stop hackers from trying. They can also edit the URL manually or tweak their HTTP request with another tool such as Postman to achieve the same result. So what do we do? There are only one rule. Never trust the client side. You want to always, always validate user input on the server side because it will be more difficult for attackers to gain access to your backend server. It is very dangerous to trust your UI. As I said earlier, not only can attackers abuse your UI, but they may not be using a browser at all. They can use some tool like Postman, which the pure purpose is to make a request, API request to the backend. So let's look at this this block of code I have here. If you have some logic like this in your backend code, you can very easily check the amount of tickets the person is requesting. And if the amount is bigger than 3, we're going to return an error at a status code 401. So far so good. We have HTML, CSS, and we've learned how to secure our client our websites using server-side validation. Then let's make our site a bit more interactive. In order to do that, we're going to need some JavaScript. JavaScript is what's called the client-side scripting language, which means it is a programming language that runs in your web browser, such as Chrome or Firefox. The way JavaScript works is interesting. It sits inside the web page, like in this example. So we've already seen the HTML tags. Now we're going to add something called a script tag. And it also has open and closed script tag. Unlike HTML contents, everything inside these tags won't be rendered on the browser. When your browser interpreter gets to this line, it will know that to treat whatever that's coming as a completely separate programming language until it finds the according closing script tag. There are many things you can do in here. You can post photos, links, calculate your rent, which makes it very powerful. The issue is JavaScript can be very dangerous if someone decides to use it in a malicious manner. One of these ways is called cross-site scripting. It is still one of the top vulnerabilities present on the web today. This allows attackers to steal private information like your cookies, account information, or to impersonate the victim on the internet. For instance, there are cases where victims got their Bitcoin stolen by by this technique. I'll be talking about two different types of cross-site scripting attacks. The first one would be reflected cross-site scripting, which is also known as non-persisting XSS attack. So what happens here is that the attacker will send a link, a malicious link, a link with malicious script appended to it, to your email or whatever, and all you have to do is click on it. And when the victim's browser opens, the malicious JavaScript code will get executed and run in the victim's browser. It basically lets the attacker on the machine. Let's look at a real example. So let's pretend I got this message in my inbox saying that, hey there, is that you in these photos? And of course I'm gonna click on it. Here we are, I just got hacked. So what's happening here? It looks like the malicious script got executed right away when the page loaded. You can see that after the regular URL, there's some what's called precurrent appended to the URL. And here, it is asking the browser to execute an alert and tell me that I got hacked. So what you just saw is the reflected XSS, because I can go back onto the website regularly and it won't pop up. Okay. So the next one would be stored cross-site scripting. Stored cross-site scripting vulnerabilities happen when the payload is saved, for example, in the database. And when user visits the designated site, it makes a request to the database and gets the problematic content. And then it renders that into the client browser. Stored XSS is dangerous because, unlike reflected ones, it potentially means that everyone who visits the site is now a victim of the attack. I'm going to use the same site you just saw to do another demo because apparently it's illegal to do it on an actual site. So here we are. All right, so we have a blog with where you can post comments. So I'm going to try to type something in. Let's see if it gets posted. Awesome. You see that my comment shows up below. So that's working as expected. So now what I'm going to do is typing something like this. We just learned about scripting. So can someone tell me what happens when I click post?
It'll show an alert.
Wait, let's try it. Actually, it doesn't. Okay, so why is it not showing an alert? We just talked about it, right? Scripts that get injected into the DOM browser via script tags in the inner HTML are not run at the time when they are injected. However, on the other hand, images that get injected to the DOM are loaded right away, and if the loading fails, then the on error event handler will be triggered. So we can do script. Let's try to post an image. So to post image in HTML, give it the ing and then give it source, but I want to trigger an error, so I'm not going to give it anything in the source. And then tell it on error, going to do something. Let's say alert. Okay. Try to post this. probably thinking, okay, this is cool, like, but I don't see how that can harm me in any way. It's just probably very annoying because every time someone tried to go on the site, this would pop up, since it's being stored in the database. However, what if instead of an alert, I'm gonna ask your browser to send me your cookie information, which contains your bank account information, account login, or anything. Or I can, what I can even do is to ask your browser to send me every keystroke you hit and write that in a file where I can access, so I can spy on you. So let's try something better. Do we know what cookies are?
It's food.
Delicious.
Okay. So we're gonna do the same thing, but instead of alerting 123, type. Gonna try to get your cookie. Oh, this is the previous one that we're about to delete. Here we are. I have some sort of secret session tokens. FYI, most of the websites nowadays don't actually store your username and password in the cookies because it's very easily hackable. So what they do is store something called a session token or authorization token. And here we are. And instead of sending an alert, I could also tell it to send it to my computer. Is stored cross-site scripting. For those of you who are young enough to remember MySpace, here's a fun fact. So MySpace was the first victim of what is called a self-propagating cross-site scripting war attack, also known as the SEMI war. So 10 years ago, by a few clever lines of code, in less than a day, Sammy, a 19-year-old hacker, become the hero, remember the hero list, your friends, and a friend to more than a million people on the popular online social network called MySpace. As you can see here. It also got him a visit from the FBI. This form instructed the web browser to load a MySpace URL that would automatically invite Sammy as a friend, and later add him as a hero to the visitor's own profile pages. And it would also copy and insert itself into the visitor's user profile, creating a self-replicating one. As he would explain, so if five people viewed my profile, that's five new friends. If five people viewed each of their profiles, that's 25 more new friends. Sammy just wanted friends. So, how do we prevent attacks like that? Luckily, all that can be easily avoided with a few simple solutions. First of all, instead of inserting your untrusted content as inner HTML into your container on the browser, you can insert them as text content. When the browser sees that it's text content, it will just ignore it and render everything as it is. But I know that not everyone's website are limited to text. Now we have GIFs, photos, and everything. So a better way to do it is sanitize all the content before adding it to the DOM. Sanitizing is the act of escaping all the entire string, the entire content as a whole. So there are already a lot of available packages you can use, such as DOM Purify, in order to help you sanitize the untrusted content. These libraries help filter out tags that aren't part of a secure whitelist. The resulting string should be safe to inject to your inner HTML. lastly, we're going to talk about something different. The previous two attacks I talked about are all client site-based attacks. And now I'm going to talk about something more on the base level, which is a direct database attack. What is an SQL injection? An SQL injection attack is when the attacker puts SQL code in place for regular input. This fools an unprotected system into running the string of characters as part of its own SQL query. SQL queries are comments you, it's how you talk to your database. It's like a specific coding language that when you try to ask something to the database, it's how you talk. Some SQL injection attack release lists of sensitive customer data while others modify a database or even erase the database entirely. So it can be very dangerous and might cost a lot of money. Here's a simple example. On the left side of the screen is a regular user who is prompted to log in with her username and password. And when she submits the credential, it will trigger an SQL query, such as below, to search in the database server. The server has a database that contains a users table, which stores name, password, and other important information. As you can probably guess by reading the query, it will try to find a user that has the matching name and password. But on the right side is a malicious user. Just by looking at the password on its own, it kind of looks like nonsense. However, once it's submitted and gets passed into your SQL query, like this, it all kind of starts. You can probably put together what it's doing. So instead of checking if password is password, it's giving it an extra option of saying also if 1 equals 1, that's fine too. And so with the correct username and a fake password or wrong password, the hacker is able to access the user's account. So what can we do to prevent that? There's no silver bullets in security. I generally suggest you to practice defense in depth methods. So we're going to look at a few things. First, consider using a web application firewall to help filter out malicious requests like this. There are a lot of good ones out there that provide a comprehensive set of rules which are highly customizable. But a WAF can be especially useful against new vulnerabilities while a patch is still being worked on. For example, I would recommend Moss Security. It's a free and open source package you can use. And software like that constantly update itself and adds new rules and features in order to catch up with the ever-changing ways hackers is going to try to hack your database. However, because hackers can always advance to something new, it doesn't provide 100% guarantee of protection. It is highly recommended that developers to implement security measure in the server-side application itself. One of these measures is prepare statements with parameterized queries. I'm going to call it PQ because I can't pronounce it. So we're going to revisit this query we had earlier that's inserted by the hacker. So from the name, it kind of sounds very scary and complicated, but the idea is actually very simple. We send the SQL query and the data to the database server separately. Why? Because the main vector of the SQL injection attack is that the client is mixing the code and the database. This works because we are inserting dynamic, untrusted data that we have no control of into the SQL query. But if we use prepare statements, we don't alter our query, it remains the same. We're sending a program to the server like this one. Look at the question mark. The question mark here is a placeholder for whatever data that will be here. And we send this query to the server without any data in it. Then when we receive the actual data input from the user, whatever, we send the data by itself, like this. The parameterized, the PQ, will not be vulnerable and will instead look for a password which literally matched the entire string. In conclusion, we learned that there are many ways and levels an application can be attacked. But there are also many solutions that would help prevent these attacks. I hope that by learning how the attackers act, you can write more secure applications and understand why the seemingly annoying protocols are in place. This is the MI presentation, and here is a famous bottom table comment. Any questions?
I think I have a question. So when you mentioned the web app firewall, would that be something that you need to install on the server where the application is served?
It's like a lot of type of firewall. There's even like a specific firewall for just SQL SQL servers. So it depends on which type you're using, but you don't actually install it on the server, like network level. So that's why. So it's not in your code base on the back end.
It's like infrastructure, right? But
right,
it's on the server side. It's not
it's on the server side.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
There's also front end firewalls, but that would protect more against like the client side attacks that we talked about. Thank you for coming.